I'd also like to welcome you all here. We have our second keynote speaker, and it was very interesting how our first discussion dealt with the academic and the policy world, and from an academic. And now we'll be talking, we will have our second keynote speaker, someone who is very much adept at the policy world. Our second speaker is His Excellency Yashaya Kish, who actually will be talking about the strategic importance of the Black Sea and the Caucasus. Yashaya Kish is a career diplomat, having served in many, many posts representing his country, Turkey, throughout his many years of service since 1962 when he joined the Foreign Ministry, and in particular, later on in his career, became ambassador to Saudi Arabia, deputy undersecretary to the ministry in 1992, and in 1995, ambassador of Turkey to Cairo, to Egypt, and therefore very much knowledgeable about what is happening around this part of the world. But since leaving the Foreign Service, he started a new career as a policymaker. And in 2001, he became founding member of the Justice and Development Party, the AK Party, here in Turkey, and its vice chairman in charge of international relations. He was elected to parliament in 2002 until last year, 2011. And during that period, between 2002 and 2003, he actually served as Turkey's foreign minister. He was also Turkey's representative to the drafting of the convention, the Treaty on Establishing of a Constitution for Europe in 2003, and had been, while he was serving in Parliament, the chairman of the EU Committee in the Turkish Parliament, as I said, and the co-chairman of the Turkey EU Joint Parliamentary Commission from 2003 to 2011. Has been decorated by Saudi Arabia, France, and Italy for his contribution to the advancement of Turkish relations with these countries, published a number of articles and books, has been very active and continues to be very active. I've had the honor and privilege of knowing him since 2004, where we take part in another enterprise that has to do with Greece and Turkey, our two countries, the Greek-Turkish Forum, where we meet periodically and discuss our issues and whether we can actually improve our relations. And I look forward, and actually I was thinking that this is actually the second time I'm introducing him, but not too long ago, while in my former life in Greece as the director of the International Center for Black Sea Studies, he was one of our keynote speakers. And so, without further ado, Ambassador, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much, Dimitri. After the previous lecture, which is a very delightful subject of philosophical depth, of course, my comments may look very shallow to you, but we are going to speak about a different subject, and for most of the audience, this subject, the geostrategic importance of the Black Sea, is a subject which is better known by many members of this audience. If it has an importance, it will reflect the perception of someone, an old man like me, who is of this region and who has his roots, ancestral roots in the Caucasus. The subject that I'm going to touch upon is divided into these subtitles or sub-headlines. That's to say, I will talk about the factors that contribute to the geostrategic importance of the region and the factors that affect the security of the region. The factors that, in order to determine the factors, we have to first of all, determine the area that we are going to cover. The area that we are going to cover is actually Black Sea and the Caucasus, which is shown in this map. But when you take the riparian countries of the Black Sea, the Black Sea basin as a whole, of course, it goes beyond this map. It goes to the entire territory of Russia and also to the Central Asian countries. When we talk about the security, security is indivisible. So whatever happens in distant countries, with countries that are riparian of the Black Sea, of course, it will have impact on the region as well. And the Caucasus that we are going to talk is this area, which is full of small and medium-sized countries, and then we will now go to the factors that contribute to the geostrategic importance of the region. We will begin by geography. Geography of the Black of this region, of course, has to be divided into two: the Caucasus and the Black Sea. If we start with the Caucasus, Caucasus is a region which is, first of all, separated from the people that live there. It is a geographical area that separates Europe from Asia, and it could be considered as a fault line that divides Muslim world from the Christian world, but something which there's also a contradiction there. In the immediate north part of the mountain chain of the Caucasus, there are predominantly Muslim population, and the immediately south of the mountain chain, there are countries like Georgia, which is very strongly Orthodox country, and also Armenia, which is the first country that adopted Christianity as the state religion. And there are also small countries whose name are indicated here: Adige, Kavardino, Balkaria, Chechnya, Ingushetia, Dagestan, etc. And in these countries, there is a variety and multitude of ethnic groups. When we come to the Black Sea, we have to divide it into two, because there is the Black Sea maritime area, which has a different set of importance, and there is the basin, which is composed of territories of the riparian countries. The maritime area of the Black Sea is, of course, the major route for the riparian countries, that's Bulgaria, Romania, Ukraine, Moldova, Russia, and Georgia. But also, the countries that use the Black Sea as the main sea route to the distant countries, such as Azerbaijan and Armenia, and also the riparian of the Caspian Sea, such as Turkmenistan, Uzbekistan, and Kazakhstan. And of course, the Black Sea is used as a sea route, but when it comes to the Turkish Straits, then it becomes more critical. And because of this importance of the Black Sea, perhaps it is the only country in the world whose international status is determined or defined by an international convention, which is Montreux Convention, which limits the size of the ships, naval vessels of the non-riparian countries in the Black Sea, and also the duration of their stay in the Black Sea. So the Montreux Convention was signed in 1936 for a period of 20 years. So with tacit, with the condition of tacit reconduction, tacit renewal, since none of the parties to the convention objected to it, it is now going on since more than 80 years. It shows that it struck a good balance of equilibrium of forces or rights and the obligations in the area, since we see that none of the parties objected to its tacit renewal. Territories of the riparian countries, of course, is the land side of the basin, and if anything happens in distant Central Asia or somewhere in Russia, which is not very close to the Black Sea, it is part of the security of the region because Russia is involved there, and then since the defense is indivisible, it will have effects, it will affect one way or another the security situation in the Black Sea basin. The topography of the mountain chain is such that it is divided with deep valleys and high mountain peaks, and for decades and centuries in the past, the dwellers of one valley did not have any relation with the next dweller of the next valley, so they developed a different language and different ethnicity. So this area is harbors multitude of ethnicity and religious mosaic. The factors that contribute to the geostrategic importance of the region comes from the ethnic mosaic ones, that's to say, uneven topography. There are 12 republics in the region: Armenia, Georgia, Azerbaijan, North and South Ossetia, Chechnya, Ingushetia, Adygey, Karachay, Cherkessia, Kabardino-Balkaria, and Dagestan, and multitude of languages as well. Only in Dagestan there were 30 languages spoken in the past, and the Russian authorities bringing together those languages which are close to other, making it one language, they reduced the number of the 30 languages to 10 languages, whose name you see it, perhaps you may be hearing for the first time all these languages. And in Dagestan, 41% of the population speaks Avar, 15% speaks Dargi, and 12% Tumuk and Lezgi and Lak and Tabasaran, Nogai, Rutul, Abdul, Saur, etc. Is it only in Dagestan? No. In another small country, Karachay Cherkessia, again there are 5 or 6 languages, which include Kazakhs 40%, Karachays 35%, Karadays and Beslanays 10%, Abkhazian 6%, and Nogais 3%. This is, of course, it could be multiplied with examples from other countries. This shows that in a small area, how many ethnic different people live there. What is it, the importance of it in the security? When there are that many ethnic entities, then of course they have different expectations, and the balance of power between them is very important. Is it only for the ethnicity? No, religion-wise also. It incorporates several religions. In Georgia and Armenia, various sects of Christianity. There are also Sunnis and Yazidi Kurds. In Azerbaijan, Muslims and Christians. And in the north of the Black Sea, remnants of Khazars, according to the theory that you may have read the famous book of Arthur Koestler, an American of Irish, of Hungarian origin, who said that when the king of Khazars adopted Jewish religion in sometimes in the 10th century, then the higher officials in the palace also adopted the Jewish religion, and then some part of the population, and when 2 centuries later Genghis Khan came and swept them to towards the west, and they became Ashkenazi Jews, and the articles that says that the majority of the Ashkenazi Jews are remnants of this Hazar population of Turkic origin. So again, if you go to Kalmuk, there are religions such as Buddhist and Shamanist, that's to say non-Abrahamic religions also exist in the region, and also Russian Orthodox are constitute the majority. So we talked about the geography and the rich ethnic mosaic, and now I will talk, if I will say a few words regarding the geopolitics of the region. I don't know how the distinguished scholars define the geopolitics, but when I was at school, something like 50 years ago, our professor of international relations defined geopolitics as in geopolitics, state is considered as a living creature tied to the geography, and this constitutes the geopolitics. And the neighbors, natural resources of the country, sensitivities of geographical location, etc., constitute part of the geopolitics. I don't know whether it evolved now, and I don't know whether there are other definitions of the geopolitics, but this is the definition that I still stick to in order to explain events in a region. And regarding the geopolitics, one dimension is the history, because historical background of people who lived there may have created first of all, some sort of mentality and approach, prejudices, and also ethnic mixture in that area. For instance, when we take the region from the historical standpoint, Black Sea divided or united, whichever way you look at it, the Khazars in the north and the Byzantine Empire at that time, when Roman Empire was divided into two in the year 395. So Eastern Roman Empire became Byzantine, and it ruled in Anatolia in the adjacent area. So south of the Black Sea was Byzantine Empire, north was Khazars, and the east was Iran. So this region that we are talking about was the bone of contention between Byzantines and Khazars, then Byzantines and Irans, and then Iranians and Ottomans, and from the 18th century onward between Russia, Ottomans, and Iran. Of course, all these rivalries left something in the history, and which is part of the geopolitics of the region. And in the social sciences, there are several layers of identity. The social science admits that identity is not something one-dimensional thing. There may be several layers, and also past, present, and future identities. In the region, what are these layers? The people of the region are the Black Sea people, Eastern Mediterranean people, Caucasus people, Muslim, Christian, Soviet. All these identities are one on top of the other. Sometimes one of these identities prevails over the other, and some other times it's another identity, it's another layer that comes to the surface. This also affects the geopolitics. If we talk about the past, present and future identity. Many countries of the former Soviet Union were they had past identity. Now they are not any longer past identity. If you take countries like Bulgaria and Romania, we may say that they were part of the Warsaw Pact identity. Now they have an identity which is the opponent of Warsaw Pact. They are members of NATO. So this change also is very important. So one country may have an opposite identity as compared to the past. When I was visiting Batumi one day, a tourist guide gave me a very interesting definition of the identity there. One of the tourists in the bus asked the tourist guide, what is the religious situation in distribution in Acara, he said. And the lady said, the grandparents were Muslim in Acara. Parents were atheist, children are Christian. So in three generations, you see the same people changing from one identity to the other. So this region went through all these changes by belonging, by becoming citizen of one country and also adherent of various religions. So these also are the elements that constitute the geopolitics. Another factor that contributes to the geostrategic importance of the region is the frozen conflicts. The frozen conflicts, of course, we know it in South Ossetia, Abkhazia, Transnistria, and Nagorno-Karabakh. I don't want to enter into the detail because it's known to all of you. South Ossetia is a small, now independent, now regarded independent country by a few countries at least. It was an autonomous oblast in the Soviet time and it became independent in 1990. Georgia abolished the autonomy and retook by force. And the South Ossetia rejected the OSCE plan in 2006. And when in August 2008 there was a military action by Georgia to retake it, Russia used this as a pretext to invade it and to declare South Ossetia an independent country. Now there are a few countries that recognize this, Russia to begin with, Abkhazia, a country called Nowra, a 10,000 population country somewhere in the Pacific. Many of us may not be able to point where it is. And also Venezuela are recognizing the independence of South Ossetia. I will go into detail a few moments later. South Ossetia is here. If you can find it, I don't know how to use it. Here. That place is South Ossetia. And let's look at it closer. The pink area, this is South Ossetia. And Abkhazia had another chance to become independent because of, for something unrelated to its own dynamics. When South Ossetia's independence was declared by Russia, Russia also declared the independence of Abkhazia. Abkhazia is a country with 550,000 population. It had in the past, now it is dwindled to half of it. And in August 2008 it also declared its independence. It's again recognized by the same countries that I mentioned. Transnistria or Transdniester, some others sometimes it's called Transdniester or Transnistria. It is between Moldova and Ukraine. It's a very small, tiny country with whose independence it is not recognized by any country, but it is still there. Nagorno-Karabakh differs from the others because of the size and because of the complexity of the situation of Nagorno-Karabakh. This is Nagorno-Karabakh. You see that it is not directly related to Armenia. So there is Azeri territory in between Nagorno-Karabakh and Armenia. And not only its independence is not recognized by other countries, Armenia does not recognize its independence either. And there are several international resolutions and decisions adopted by the Council of Europe, by the European Union, by the United Nations, and by the United States that recognize, that does not recognize the independence of Nagorno-Karabakh, and that it considers, that they consider as part of Azerbaijan. Nagorno-Karabakh issue, of course, it's a core issue, but it's not the entirety of the problem. There is one Nagorno-Karabakh's independence, but also there are five provinces or seven provinces of Azerbaijan which is under occupation of Armenia, and there is 1/5 of Azerbaijan's population which are internally displaced persons. So Nagorno-Karabakh issue has to be divided into two. One is the independence of Nagorno-Karabakh, the other is the population internally displaced people and also territories under occupation. When we assess the risks of the frozen conflict for the peace, we may say that the South Ossetia, now that Russia has recognized its independence, and Russia says that the Russian forces that are stationed both in Abkhazia and South Ossetia are Russian forces staying there under bilateral agreements with the countries, with the governments of these countries. So they consider it as independent country and Russian presence there under bilateral agreement. What does it have, what effect does it have on our subject? It means that Russia will stay there, and that if Russia does not agree to withdraw its armies there, I don't see which country will go into the armed conflict with Russia to uproot the Russians there and expel the Russians from South Ossetia. It is not likely to happen. Most probably Russia would look for an opportunity in the future if the international landscape allows them to push the independence further. They will seek the recognition of additional countries, and this is how most probably they will handle this question. The same criteria applies also to Abkhazia. Therefore, for Abkhazia and South Ossetia, I don't see any threat breakout of hostilities in these countries that may spill over to the other countries of the region and that may upset the power balance there. in Transnistria, Transnistria, you have seen the place of the location of this small strip on the map. It is between Moldova and Ukraine. The history of the conflict is that this place was inhabited by the Russian-speaking people. And when Moldova has become independent, Moldovans speak a language which is close to Romanian, and the Russian-speaking people thought that they were left in the out, so they declared their independence. What does this mean? The independent, as an independent country, its sustainability is questionable because it has no, it is a landlocked country with 90,000 population. It's not easily sustainable. It's joining Russia is not feasible because there is the entire Ukrainian territory in between. So most probably it will remain there. Since it doesn't hurt any sensitivity of the outside stakeholders, it may remain so. So it is not a threat again to the security of the region. When we come to Nagorno-Karabakh, the situation is slightly different, because in the Nagorno-Karabakh, both sides, I think, are preparing themselves, one to continue to hold, the other to get it back. The Minsk group, which was chaired by three co-chairs, that's to say United States and France and Russia. If we take France, well, France showed its bias in the, its bias for Armenia by passing a law recently in the French Parliament to punish the negation of genocide. This is a position taken by France in favor of Armenia. It has nothing to do with Azerbaijan, but it is a gesture by France that it is biased in favor of Armenia. So in the case of Minsk group, this situation could be compared to a court case where one of the judges is in favor of one of the parties in the conflict. What could be the solution? One solution could be that when France was brought to this position, was made co-chair, at that time it was, this could be a solution perhaps to make some progress in the Nagorno-Karabakh issue. When we look at Russia, Russia does not have any interest to see this question solved soon. On the contrary, it may prefer that this question remain unsolved. Why? Because it allows Russia to keep military presence in Armenia. If the Nagorno-Karabakh issue is solved, then the Armenians may turn to Russians and say, "Oh Russians, thank you very much for the support that you extended to us. Now we don't need any longer your presence," and Russia may have been forced to leave. So for this reason, Russia does not have an interest to see this question solved soon. When we turn to the third co-chair, United States, there, United States, rather than American interest in the region, seems to prefer the advantage or the interest of a small but very efficient diaspora, Armenian diaspora, in the United States. So these three co-chair of Minsk group do not give me at least very much hope that this question will be solved soon. If it gets out of control, then of course there are countries outside the region or in the region that have stayed there, and it may spill over to the region. This is a risk that I see there. Another factor that contributes to the geostrategic importance of the Black Sea and Caucasus is the closeness of this region to the energy sources. If you look at the map, Persian Gulf and Persian Gulf Basin and the Caspian Sea Basin harbors or contain 72% of the world's gas and oil reserves. 72% of the entire world's gas and oil reserves are in this area. It is immediately to the east of the region that we are talking about. Then when we look to the west, Europe is the 40% of the, constitutes 40% of the world's energy consumption. The biggest consumption is in this area. And the area that we are talking about is now just in between, so it constitutes the route for the energy sources. This closeness or this unique situation, of course, makes the region a little more important. I had several maps, but I couldn't. Well, when you look at this map, first of all, you see with the figures, I don't know whether you were able to see that. The red ones are the natural gas. For instance, in let's say Azerbaijan, it says 0.9 trillion cubic meter of gas and 7 billion barrel of oil. And in the Turkmenistan, 2.8 trillion cubic meter of gas and 0.6 billion barrel of oil. And the other figures have to be read in the same manner. So these are the quantities, which is huge. And you see on this map the gas and the oil pipelines that cross the Black Sea and also Anatolia. There was another map that I couldn't find, which shows also the pipeline that goes through Russia, which is much more than the ones that you see through Turkey. So this region, both the maritime area of the Black Sea, so the sea itself, and also territories around it, are very important for the transport of the sources of energy. So anything that happens in this area, instability and threat to the security, it will also endanger the supply of oil and gas to the Western countries and to the world market. Now I will say a few words regarding the factors that affect the security outside the region. One is the Arab Spring. Arab Spring, of course, has nothing to do. There is nothing common between Arab Spring countries and the countries of the region. Many of the regional countries, let's say, for instance, Ukraine, has already crossed that period of revolting, and in Georgia, the what we call the Rose, what is it, Rondelli? Rose Revolution, yes. Rose Revolution, and the other was the Orange Revolution. So they have passed this. In the Central Asia, this transition from Communist Party to the post-communist era is also completed. But some of the leaders of the communist era are still there. It doesn't mean that they have to be replaced because they managed the transition in an excellent manner. They may stay there, but in certain countries, now that the transition from the communist era to post-communist era is over, they may want to make another step. And is it going to be a revolution or something else? We do not know. But there may be movement in this area as well. But in the Caucasus itself, we don't expect to see anything like this. But if it happens, of course, it will have negative consequences. From the comparison between various elements of the frozen conflict, it's only Nagorno-Karabakh issue which threatens the peace and stability in the region, because Azerbaijan is now an oil-rich country. It has a population three times as much as Armenia, and each year that it now starts to make available gas and oil, and exploration are complete, and the production of oil and gas is now coming. Most probably, Azerbaijan will allocate more money to the defense equipment, with all the consequences that you can expect from it. Now, today already, the defense budget, only defense budget of Azerbaijan, is more than the entire national budget of Armenia. And when this continues like that, of course, I don't see how Armenia could be able to obtain something that it could obtain today, how it can obtain more in the future. We have to see it. Iran is another factor that has to be taken into consideration. Iran is taking steps steadily to become a nuclear power. Whether the program is there or not, it's irrelevant. It is becoming an important country. It was already an important country. It has a statehood tradition of 2,500 years. And there are now opinions expressed here and there by irresponsible people, in my opinion, saying that now that Gaddafi is gone, next is Syria, and then after that it will be Iran. I don't give much credit to this type of threatening voices, but if Iran is attacked, of course, Iran will not remain idle. It has the capacity to strike back. It has. It may not be two divisions of army sent to other countries, but it has means to strike back through other manners. It may cause big damage to the interests of the countries that are the source of the threat for it in other fields. So all these elements show that the region is very important strategically. Several fault lines crosses this region, and if this security, if you do not pay sufficient attention to maintenance of the security of this region, then it may light up there, and it may have spillover effects in other region. Here I will conclude my presentation, and thank you very much for your attention.
Well, thank you very much for your presentation, Mr. Minister.
In a way,
it's good. In a way, you gave us an overview, which sometimes we forget about the many issues in the region, the religious and ethnic mosaic, the diversity of the region, the different layers of identity, and how identities change across generations, and the various issues that come up, and as policymakers, as a policymaker, one has to look at. One is addressing the importance of the region. We have time for a couple of questions before we go to our coffee break. But I would also, I would like to start off and ask you a question regarding Turkey and the region. I mean, we will be talking maybe about it also in our next panel. But you know, ultimately, how important is the region or isn't the region for Turkey? Simple question. It's up to you to...
Actually, Turkey's interest is not threatened at present in the region, but Turkey is the custodian of the Montreux Convention, and it may run into trouble because of this. In the year 2008, 8th of August 2008, the South Ossetian crisis, everybody had forgotten that there was a convention called Montreux Convention, and the Americans rushed to send a hospital ship of 68,000 tons of capacity. Whereas, according to the Montreux Convention, in no case the naval vessels of non-riparian countries in the Black Sea could not exceed 45,000 tons. And when Americans were reminded of this, they of course did not insist, and they sent a small ship of 12,000 tons. So if in the future some countries, especially now that the Black Sea has become also an area of interest of both NATO and the European Union, because two of the riparian countries join both NATO and the European Union, it has become a NATO sea as well, a closed sea, and whose custodian is Turkey. Custodian is translated in Arabic as servant also. So Turkey is only keeping the records. It is not, Turkey is not going to get involved in war if there is a breach, a violation. It will be responsible not observing properly these rules. So one threat is there. Second is that Nagorno-Karabakh issue, of course, is between Azerbaijan and Armenia, but because of the close relations between Turkey and Azerbaijan, one way or another, Turkey will be implicated in this conflict if it turns to a hot conflict. I hope that doesn't happen, and I hope that the negotiated solution will be there. Apart from this, the other sensitivities are not directed to Turkey.
Well, thank you. So maritime security and the Nagorno-Karabakh issue implications. Any questions from the floor? Yes, sir.
Hello. Thank you, Mr. Minister, for an enlightened presentation. I would like to ask a very short and very current question. How do you evaluate the latest general election in Georgia, and how do you evaluate then the freedom of Saakashvili?
Of course, I don't look at the defeat of Saakashvili. Do you mean in the election, this party was? Is it one, or are you referring to the South Ossetia issue? Which one? Which defeat you are referring to?
Elections.
Well, elections, of course, is a democratic process, and none of the political parties remain in power for ever there. And the more the mature in democracy, the better. Of course, His Excellency Saakashvili contributed a lot to this transition, to secure stability in the country. But if his party now lost a number of seats, it's not the end of the world. Georgians, I think, are getting mature enough to continue this process, whoever becomes president of the republic, whether his party is losing or not. I don't think that there is any alarming, there is anything alarming in the decrease of the seats of Mr. Saakashvili's party.
Serkan Bulut, PhD student of University of Delaware. Thank you very much for the informing speech. I would like to hear your perspective about the main argument of the previous speech, actually. Do you think good scholarship makes good policy, as you're coming from the diplomacy and politics side of the policy making? And do you think good scholarship is informing Turkish foreign policy in the last decade? Thank you.
I think that these areas perform their duty better if they are kept separately. That's to say, politicians have to benefit from the scholarly researches and assessments. And when we were drafting the program of the party, in my capacity as the founding member of the party, we were six of us to draft the program of the party. I was the one who initiated the idea of that the foreign policy should not be conducted only with the views provided by the public servants of the diplomat in the Ministry of Foreign Affairs, but the civil society organizations and the universities also should be consulted, and they should be commissioned to write papers and position papers and contribute to this. Actually, I expected that this will be also observed, these ideas will be better observed when Mr. Davutoğlu became Minister of Foreign Affairs, because he came from academia. So I thought that at least this part of what we have written in the program will be observed. But I think that the older tradition in the Turkish foreign ministry continues, doing it without consultation. This is not the answer to your question. But now I come to the more straightforward answer to your question. To write a book when you lock yourself up in between four walls and write a book, develop theories, it is one thing, because to explain your theory, to construct your theory, you pick up the best examples that you find in the international arena, past examples, etc., for geographical, geostrategical elements, and you may develop an excellent theory, an idea. But when you go a field, the field is completely different. In the field, you will find a small country whose name you did not even mention in your books may come up with a stupid idea, irrational and unexplainable, but as a sovereign country, he may implement this idea. And when you ask him, what on the earth are you doing? This is wrong, this is irrational. They will say, I'm a sovereign country, I do whatever I want. So, writing theories is one thing, but when you go to the field, something that you have never thought of, it may be rational. Napoleon went to Moscow with 450,000 soldiers and came back with 45,000 people. It was irrational. But countries do also irrational things. So this has to be taken into consideration when this comparison has to be made.
Thank you. If there's no other question,
there is. Yes.
Nice presentation and for the historic overview. And I would like to ask, how have the strategic importance of the regions of the Black Sea region evolved throughout the 1990s and 2000s for Turkey? Because previously it was perceived mainly as a source of threats, and now very often the Black Sea region as well as all other regions are perceived as the source of new opportunities for Turkey. So how could you please define the strategic importance of the Black Sea region?
I was fortunate enough to be at that time very closely involved in the establishment of the Black Sea Economic Cooperation. The idea that came at that time from a former diplomat, Mr. Elekta, who said that now that the Soviet Union is dismembered, there is a golden opportunity for Turkey and to transform the Black Sea into an area of cooperation. And this idea was picked up by the late President Özal and it was put into implementation. And I was deputy undersecretary in the Foreign Ministry. So the Black Sea Economic Cooperation is born into my arms, and I saw how this evolved. The opportunities have always been there. But of course, the Iron Curtain divided the Black Sea from the middle. Before the Iron Curtain, you may remember that Black Sea was at one time Ottoman inner land, then shared with Russia, but not cut with an Iron Curtain. The potentials are there, and this potential is now being explored. But the Black Sea Economic Cooperation did not reach the level of success that it was initiated at the beginning. I remember Mr. Shevardnadze, when during the meeting of when it was going to establish the establishing the founding ceremony, he also proposed to give defense dimension to it. But Turkey, being in NATO, could not easily support this idea. So the eagerness at that time was even to take the Black Sea further away. And my idea at that time was to make the Black Sea Economic Cooperation something stronger than that. And I had in mind that the chairmanship of it, or the Secretary General of it, should be made a person of very high standing, like Mr. Gorbachev, who has access to the heads of state, and make this organization a very dynamic organization. And I sent my assistant, my deputy, to Moscow to negotiate this with Russia. Russians told us that they understood the importance that we attribute to it, but they would try to send someone very skilled and very fit for that post. And they sent the second man in the Washington Embassy of Russia, Mr. Kutovo. Of course, he is a very, very, very good person, but Gorbachev type of thing was something which could have transformed the Black Sea Economic Cooperation to something different. So these ideas were there, but there are realities also in the field, as I was mentioning in answer to your question. The realities allowed us to go only this far, but the potentials are there. The Black Sea Economic Cooperation is not yet performing to the level of the expectations that were present at the beginning.
Well, thank you very much, Mr. Minister. We'll break it off here, and we'll take a coffee break. For those wanting coffee, to the left. For those that want to smoke, to the right. And we'll be back in about 25 minutes for our panel discussion on Turkey and export policy. Thank you.